I've been doing quite a lot of videos recently on tasks and parallelization and that sort of thing. And I think this is going to be the last for a while on that sort of subject. But there is one final piece of the jigsaw that we need to look at, which is the idea of value task. So let's have a look at the application I've got here. And this is actually pretty much what I was using in an earlier video, just to show the idea of tasks. So we've got this class called service access, and it's got an async method, returns a task of string called getDataAsync. And basically it uses HTTP client, makes the async get, awaits that, calls the website, and then caches the response. So we again do await to convert the response into a string, and we pop that into the cache. And so the cache there is a nullable string. And so the idea is the first time we call getDataAsync, the cache will be null. So we do the work of the async call and return what we get back. But on all subsequent times, we will already have the data. So we just return the cache data. And therefore, there will be no asynchronous activity. So although the method is marked as async, that doesn't mean it has to be async. That just means it can be when we go through the path that has the awaits, but doesn't for the rest of it. And then if we look at the program for that, what I've done is I've created that service access, looped through a couple of times just so we can see it not cached and cached, and then we're just printing out some information. So I call that, have a look at what thread we're running on, and have a look at the state of the task, whether it's completed successfully. I then await the task, so that's the point that it should be running asynchronously. I'll then pick up after that and print out the same information once again, and then just display the first 60 characters of the result. The page is going to be too big to display the whole thing. But if we run that up and drag that over, then we can see that we have iteration 0, so before the await we're in thread 1, and obviously the task hasn't been completed. Then after the await, the task has been completed, and we've picked up in the thread that the async functionality was running. And so remember, we saw this in an earlier video. If this were a GUI application, WPF or WinForms, it would put us back into the main thread so that we can access the GUI elements. But in a console application, it just carries on in the thread we're working in, so we can see it's completed successfully and we're on a different thread. And there we've got those first 60 characters of the output. But then on iteration 1, we just carry on round in the same thread. But then, because we had the cached version now returning, there's no asynchronous functionality to work. And so we simply have the true coming back there. After the await, no change at all. The await just goes straight through. There's no calling of asynchronous functionality. And so we have the true there again. So that's really nice. That means we get the best of both worlds. Or almost, because there is still one slight problem with that, which is that we are returning a task. And a task is a reference type. And that means the task exists on the heap, which has a little bit of an overhead. So whenever we have something allocated on the heap, we've got the overhead of allocation, and then we've got the overhead of garbage collection when that comes round. Now, when we're dealing with asynchronous code, we have to store the task on the heap because only the heap is accessible from multiple threads. So in that first time around, when we started out on thread 1, which is where the task was created, and then on thread 8, where we got the data back, those are different threads. Therefore, they're not sharing the same stack. Therefore, we can't have a value type existing on the stack. We've got to have the reference type existing on the heap. But that's only true on that first call to get data async when we are actually doing something asynchronous. All of the subsequent calls are going to be going straight through, just returning the cache. And so it's a bit of a wasted allocation to be creating this task object on the heap when we don't need to share it across the different threads. And that's what the value task is there for. Now, just to emphasize, this is a pretty small overhead, the difference between allocating on the stack and allocating on the heap, but it can add up. It's certainly worth considering. And if you're having performance problems, this may be something worth looking at. So what we can do is change that task to a value task. And if we then look back at the program. It's all working perfectly well. Okay, if we look at that task, that's now a value task. We've just used var so that we can infer the type. But if we run that up now, we shouldn't actually see any difference. So here we've got the results. And once again, we start on thread 1, we complete on thread 8, then we carry on thread 8 and don't need to change thread because we've already completed successfully. Let's have a look at what's actually happening there, though. So let's put a break just in here after we've got hold of the value task. And if we run up to that point and have a look at the task, we can see that it's got some very familiar things that we'd have from a regular task. The value task has got the is cancelled, the is completed successfully, and the is faulted. It's missing quite a few other things. But what's more interesting is if we look inside the non-public members. Because what we can see there, the two important ones, are the underscore obj and the underscore result. Because a value task is what is sometimes described as a discriminated union. That's to say, it can contain one or other of two completely different types. And you can see what it's got in the obj. Well, obj is actually a task, so a regular task, not a value task. So that's the task that's waiting to complete. And if we then go round again, so this is now the second iteration where we're getting back the cached data. And if we take a look at that, we can now see that that obj is null. So the inner task is not there at all. We've simply got the result. And you can see that's the beginning of that web page that I was fetching. So what's happening here is that on the first call, when we do have asynchronous code, automatically, the system is creating a task so that it can run asynchronously, and it's putting that task inside the value task. So the value task on the stack as a value type is just a wrapper in that case for the reference type, which is on the heap. So in that first instance, we're not really saving anything because we're still doing heap allocation. But then the second time around, when we don't go through any of the weights, when we just return the cache value, then this time the value task is just containing the result directly because the result is there available to us. We don't have to do anything asynchronous. And so that's why we saw that difference. It's a bit tricky to be looking at that in the debugger. So what I've put in here is just a little helper function called showPrivates, which uses reflection to have a look at those private fields, the obj and the result, and then just prints out to tell us whether they're null or not. And we should always see it's always going to be one or the other. So if we just in here put in a show privates on the task, and then the same thing in here, then when we run that up now, then we can see iteration 0, we have the obj, the task, has a value, and the result is null. Even after we've done the await, that's still the same thing, because when we get the value off the value task, so that's basically when we do the await there, it's actually coming off the inner task that's wrapped up. So we're still seeing that the obj has value. So once you've got back on that first iteration, the value task wrapping the task, that isn't going to change. But then on the second iteration, here we can see, obviously it's completed successfully already, but in this case, therefore, the inner task is null. So that's the situation where it hasn't created the inner task. It's just got the result, the value, and again, exactly the same after we've done the await. The await is now doing absolutely nothing at all. We're remaining on the same thread. It'll just go straight through there. And that underscore result is basically what we get back off the await. So it's a pretty simple idea, but it can save quite a lot of performance, particularly in this sort of situation. If we had iterated through this 100 times, then only in the first case would we be allocating anything on the heap. 99 of those cases would be much faster because we've just got the stack allocation. So there can be some quite big performance improvements there. So as a general rule, if your asynchronous function is caching, or has any circumstances where it has a path that doesn't use an await, and therefore it's not actually always running asynchronously, then it may be worth having a value task rather than just a task. If you've got a situation where you always call the await, so if we were always going back to that website because we wanted the freshest data or something like that, then there wouldn't be any real benefit to it. That said, there's not a huge disadvantage to it, but there are a couple of rules that you've got to be aware of. Essentially, if you've got a regular task, you can actually await it as many times as you like, and it will all work fine. After the first await, it's not going to do very much, but it's still allowed. Whereas with a value task, although it won't always fail, the recommended rules are you only ever await a value task once. What that also means is you shouldn't block on a value task, so you shouldn't call the result directly. You should always do the await. And also, you shouldn't be running value tasks using things like when any or when all, which again we saw in an earlier video, which allows us to see the first task to complete or all of the tasks to complete. Well, you shouldn't do that with value tasks. You should only do it with regular tasks. So there are some restrictions that you've got to be a bit careful about, but actually in most cases, that's not always something that's going to be an issue. One other last thing to look at. Remember again, when we were looking at this earlier, we have the idea that quite often we're going to have an interface and we're going to be doing mocking. So although this is great for the real application, what if we wanted to mock it for some kind of test? So what I can do here is just do the usual extract interface. So there we've got our I service access, and then let's implement that interface with a new class. So we'll call this mock service access, and we'll just make that public, and then we'll implement the I service access. Just put that in there. And then what we saw, remember, we wanted to do, we don't make this async because all we're going to do is return. And what we did previously with a task, we had the task.fromResult. Well, we do also have that with a value task. So I could have said ValueTask.fromResult dummy data or something like that. But actually, what you'll more normally see is you can actually just directly call a constructor. So I could just say new value task for string and just pop it straight in there, which you can't do with a regular task, but you can do with a value task. And so that's the easiest way that we can implement it. And so if we now go back to our program and we'll change that to the mock service access. And also just quickly, let's get rid of that range because it will fail if you try to have a range of 60 on something that's not that long. So if we run that up, then we can now see that it's all happening in the same thread. Obviously, we're just getting the dummy data and it's always got a result. It's never got a task in there. There is one slight problem that I can see with this, in that the decision as to whether you want a value task or a regular task is an implementation detail. So it's when we're looking here in the service access, just like async is an implementation detail, it's not really part of the interface of getDataAsync, it's about how it's implemented. Similarly, whether we have a value task or a regular task is a detail, because in this case, we know it's a good idea to have a value task because we are caching, and therefore we will get some benefit because we're not asynchronous every time. But in a different implementation of getDataAsync, you might not have any caching, and therefore you might as well just have the task. But the problem is, there is no inheritance relationship between a value task and a task. So if we go to the interface, now the interface should be implementation neutral. We don't know whether we're going to have caching or not. So you might think, well, let's just be general there and put a task. But because there's no inheritance relationship, having a task in the interface has to be implemented by a task. You can see it's objecting that we haven't implemented that. And also the other way around. So if you do have an interface, if the interface is just being used for mocking, well, that should be fine anyway, because really you've only got one genuine implementation, one mock implementation. You don't care about performance on the mock implementation. So your choice of whether you have a value task or a regular task should just depend on your one implementation. So here, value task makes sense. But if you've got an interface that is really being used for multiple alternative non-testing implementations, then you're in a bit of a problem, because some of them may want value tasks, some of them may want reference tasks, and you've got to decide on the basis of performance and other issues as to which is the best to go with. So it's not a perfect solution, but certainly in simple situations where you know for sure what your implementation is going to be, this can have some performance benefits. So that's it for value tasks. That's it, as I say, for a while for tasks and parallelization in general. So I hope you enjoyed that. If you did, do subscribe, do click like, and I'll see you next time.